It is great to be on with you again, and I hope you had some time to digest everything we talked about last time. I have had some terrific feedback on part one of our nutrition hacks that mainstream nutritionists and doctors don't know, and a lot of you have been taking it that extra mile, and you've been sharing our replay with friends and family. And that's terrific because my mission is to help as many people as possible live a long and healthy life, not worrying about where their health is going to be in 30, 40, or 50 years. I want to give you practical and time-tested strategies that will take the burden off you so you can focus on what matters most, loving your families and following your purpose, really doing the mission, the real reason you were on the planet, not stressing about your health. I know many of you on this webinar are familiar with who I am and have been to some of our 100-plus living events, but we've got a lot of first-timers on the line too, so I want to take a second to let you know who I am and what I'm all about. I'm Dr. Graham Jenkins, and I'm a chiropractor, I'm a speaker, I blog, and I'm an author. But most of all, I am a lifelong student of human performance. I have either worked in healthcare or been in private practice for coming up on 23 years now, and I can say in all my experience, I have seen the good, the bad, and the ugly. And so all this information, the way that I run my private practice and the advice I give is based on one question. Would this advice be advice that I would give to my wife, my kids, my extended family? If it doesn't fit that qualifier, if it's too complicated, expensive, or may not necessarily get results, I don't do it, and I will not recommend it to my clients. And as you'll learn later, what I recommend has also been tested in the laboratory of life. I don't just kind of throw stuff out there that I read last week. It's got to be time tested. And the reason I've split this content into two sessions is that I've found that information overload really tends to result in paralysis. So rather than taking a couple of great ideas, kind of mulling it over, thinking about how it's going to fit in your life, determine an action plan, and then going for it, too much information all at once often just makes people feel like there's too much to do and they quit even before they begin. So my hope is that with a few days in between, or you can watch the first video and this one from the previous webinar, then you can process it and then move forward without feeling overwhelmed. Add it to your life when you have the bandwidth. So if you missed part number one or just found out about our nutrition hack series in time for this session, you can simply swing back and watch the replay of part one. So just a quick recap. We talked about upregulating our parasympathetic nerve system so our body is healing. And if you remember, we showed you this slide. In our modern day culture, there are very few things that don't make the sympathetic or the stress side of the nerve system go absolutely bonkers. Remember I shared with you what population scientist Dr. Donald Klum has found scientifically that upregulates the parasympathetic response. This is likely the most misunderstood and underutilized hack of all, hacking your central nervous system. So meditation, which we term peace management, a very specific chiropractic adjustment to the spine to release that nerve system. And then the third practice that's been scientifically proven to upregulate the parasympathetic side of the nerve system is rhythmic or diaphragmatic breathing. These all have science behind them, so it's essential to have them in your longevity toolbox. And I know from being a chiropractor for so many years, a lot of people are using their chiropractic care to beat low back pain and neck pain, and that's a great start. But the real benefit is for your longevity and metabolism because of what it does for your nerve system. In fact, there's actually more research showing that looking after your nerve system is for every other system in your body, so digestion, immunity, even your ability to get a good night's sleep. So to get to sleep and stay asleep, it's related to the tone of your nerve system. There's more research showing that than there is that chiropractic's effective in neck and back pain. So as chiropractors, we really need to do a way better job in educating people that the true power in a chiro adjustment is really about nerve system health more than pain. See, our culture's got a long way to go to understand what today's chiropractic is all about. And I take it personally. It's up to docs like me to make sure people understand, or else people will just think their only option to restore their health is drugs and surgery. And as much as drugs and surgery, may save your life in a crisis or from some trauma that you're in, they don't make you healthy. And you know what? They were never designed to restore your health. So today's chiropractic is a critical missing link for most Canadians if your goal is to live a long and healthy life. Okay, so let's get back to our summary from part one. You know, I really do get amped up about talking about a chiropractic adjustment because even in the area of nutrition, without a healthy nerve system, people will continue to invest time and energy and sometimes a lot of money to improve their diet and get mediocre results. It's because the nerve system is the engine that drives great nutrition and leads you to an awesome long life. And so without that engine, all the great fuel isn't going to do what it's supposed to do. So in part one, we talked about healthy fat and how that connected to driving the parasympathetic side of the nerve system, so that green arrow, and how sugar actually fuels the sympathetic side of the seesaw, and how in North America, we are cranked up on that red side, that red arrow. And before I forget, tonight is the night that I draw for the lucky winners of our giveaways. So our friends at Glow Juicery in Kelowna, so that's Kathleen, has taken 10% off all their January juice cleanses for anyone who attends these webinars. So make sure you head over there to take advantage of all the great opportunities they have and the options they've got to get a good start in the beginning of the year. So they're right beside the new Landmark 6 building. And I really encourage people to look to juicing as a healthy replacement for their second cup of coffee in the morning or mid-afternoon, especially if you can juice and consume it almost immediately because of the great enzymes and micronutrients that are in fresh pressed juice. In fact, in a couple of minutes, I'll be sharing you some research from Dr. Russell Baylock, and he'll talk about how antioxidants and natural anti-inflammatories have been shown to help you in beating diabetes. So that's in hack number two. And we're also giving away a $50 gift certificate to the Yellow House restaurant here in Kelowna and a full day family pass to Myra Canyon Adventure Park. So if you guys haven't heard about Myra Canyon Adventure Park, it's a hoot. So a great family day for sure, or at least a good few hours anyway. And yes, you need to be on the live webinar to qualify so we can keep track on who's been here and who hasn't. So the replays don't count. All right, so when we wrap up tonight, the last thing I'm going to do in our live Q&A is do the draw for all our prizes. And sorry, guys, I know we've got a lot of people on the line, even as far away as Ontario. These prizes really aren't going to work for you. But hey, if you want to make the trip to Kelowna, you're welcome. We love visitors. But I got to give you a warning. Visitors often turn into residents once they spend some time here. So don't say I didn't warn you if you come here and you never leave. So that's what happened to us. So let's get into hack number two and hack number three. So hack number two is why insulin is not the enemy and how this other hormone, leptin, fits in and how you can hack your body to make sure these hormones work for you rather than against you. So hack number two is going to really make your life a whole lot simpler. And this hack will help you avoid the number one preventable disease on the planet right now that's estimated to be affecting one in every 10 North Americans. So type 2 diabetes. So they're saying right now that 10% of the population type 2 diabetes, which is just outrageous. This is out of control and it just keeps getting worse every year. So hack number three is about how critical it is to get clean. And it's more than just doing a 30-day cleanse or going off sugar for a few days in a challenge. That's a great start, but we absolutely have to have a slow and steady trend towards a cleaner grocery cart every year if we're going to reach a healthy 100, with our mind still sharp, so no dementia, no mental issues, and our body still functioning. So you can get down on the ground, roll around with your grandkids, have a blast, get up, and you don't pay for it for 3 days afterwards. For that point, for hack number three, I'm going to share some insight from a couple that we interviewed a couple of years ago during one of our 100 plus living workshops. And they've been in the organic food industry for almost 30 years. And they gave us some incredible hints on how to do organic without going broke. So things like finding veggies that may not be certified organic, but come from local growers that don't use pesticides or herbicides. So it's kind of as close to growing your own garden as you can get, but without all the work. We'll break down the keys to help you start the process of getting clean and show you how you can begin to have a much less toxic grocery cart affordably. Okay, so let's dive in with why insulin is not the bad guy and discovering this incredible hormone called leptin and why it's critical for you to regulate both of these hormones if you're going to live a long and healthy life, a 100+ living life. So this is why insulin is not the bad guy. Russell Balok. He's a medical doctor who's completely turned his back on the chemical industry, so he does not do drugs anymore. He's dedicated his life to the pursuit of natural solutions to chronic health issues. And if you want to pick up a literal Bible on nutrition, get his book, Health and Nutrition Secrets That Can Save Your Life. It is an amazing, amazing book. It'll be a resource for the rest of your life if you go out and pick that one up. And he's got a chapter on diabetes. And in that chapter, he explains the real issue behind diabetes, type 2 in particular. And he talks about insulin. And he talks about how insulin really is not the issue, but rather something called insulin resistance, brought on by the damage from free radicals and chronic whole body inflammation. So he goes step by step through study after study, breaking down the modern day failure to deal effectively with diabetes by focusing on insulin rather than the underlying cause. You know, it is more than an interesting read. And so this is where we're getting some of this research from. So he says ultimately the best strategy to stabilize insulin, so the ups and downs of sugar, right, is to eat a diet high in antioxidants, vitamin C and E in particular. He also talks about something called pycnogenol and curcumin. Now, for you who've been around for a while, you'll recognize both of those because they're an essential element when we're talking about beating heart disease in our 100 plus living talk. Now we do that in February, so if you're interested in that, just watch. We're converting that over to webinar as well. It is an amazing, amazing talk. And a lot of what I learned was from my dad's experience with a near fatal heart attack and quad bypass surgery, and just how archaic the advice around heart disease is even today in a nation like Canada where we should know better. So that's really the root of where that workshop came from, because I just couldn't believe that the heart disease industry was so lost. Anyway, long story short, Dad's not on any medication. He is doing awesome. But pycnogenol and curcumin, those are two things that are big in his repertoire to make sure that there's no trouble down the road there. So getting back to Dr. Balok, sorry, I went off a little bit on our beating heart disease workshop, but Dr. Balok quotes studies where insulin resistance decreased dramatically in men who consumed high amounts of fruits and veggies. Now, most of the research, you know, there is more research getting with women and heart disease, but because heart disease has been such a massive thing in men, most of the studies over the last 30 years or so have been done with men. So they were particularly, you know, the kind of fruits and veggies that they're talking about is the non-starchy kind. So things like sweet potatoes versus the traditional white potatoes. He also brings to light that diabetics have significantly elevated homocysteine levels compared to non-diabetics. So sorry, I'm getting a little bit sciencey here, but homocysteine is a common indicator of whole body inflammation and an almost completely absent immune response. So basically, if you've got high homocysteine levels, that means your immune system's shot and your body's inflamed. And this is why Dr. Balok says that's another reason that diabetics are prone to infection. So what does this mean to people who are not diagnosed with diabetes? Okay, so I want to read a quote from his book. So this is from Dr. Russell Balok's Health and Nutrition Secrets That Can Save Your Life. So stick with me, it's just a couple paragraphs. Here we go. The flavonoid curcumin, so that's extract from turmeric. So turmeric is that bright orangey yellow spice in a lot of East Indian foods. So the curcumin remarkably enhances immunity and promotes white blood cell proliferation. So white blood cells are kind of the little Pac-Man that go around and eat up bacteria and viruses in your body. So you want to have a lot of those, not too many, but a lot, you know. So it promotes white blood cell proliferation and wound healing. Vitamin C, zinc, and the B vitamins also play a role in wound healing, especially in the diabetic. Now listen to this paragraph. This is kind of a classic summary of what's going on. So an enormous amount of this evidence was presented at the American Diabetics Association Symposium on the role of antioxidant therapy on diabetes. So the information furnished at this symposium was published in the journal Diabetes Care. So they had the symposium and then they published the results, just saying, you know, how critical it is that, you know, diabetics take look at antioxidants because we're seeing some great things happening. This is the final sentence in Dr. Blaylock's paragraph here, unfortunately, it had little impact on doctors who treat diabetes. So kind of what I found with my dad in the heart disease world, I'm like, really, you guys are like 50 years behind on this? This is what's happening. This research is getting presented, it's getting delivered, it's getting published, but it's not making it to the doctors who actually deal, or the doctors who deal with these issues don't actually incorporate it in their private practice. So no wonder diabetes is going through the roof. So let's boil this all down. So I know I went a bit researchy with you, but if you can pick out the keys here from Dr. Blaylock, and they are that antioxidants like vitamin C, vitamin E, and zinc, and then the anti-inflammatories like curcumin, these are the things that will open up your cells to be more sensitive to insulin and promote wound healing. And if you remember from our research from Dr. Klum, healing is all on that green arrow side of our diagram, which is another way to say we're upregulating the parasympathetic side of the nerve system. And the positive side effect is that you're taking strides to avoid diabetes at the same time. So if you've ever heard me talk on nutrition and supplements before, I'm a huge believer in getting your nutrition from your food first. Then and only then, after you've done everything you can there to increase the nutrient density and quality of your food that you put in your grocery cart, only after that you look to supplement, and you need to supplement with a high quality pharmaceutical grade supplement. So the supplements that we have on our kitchen counter are from Pure Encapsulations. It's a company that unfortunately is only available in chiropractic offices like ours, because I've literally taken a test to be able to sell their stuff. So they just don't want anybody selling this stuff. They want somebody with knowledge and some experience in this. So either a chiropractor who has spent a ton of time doing some extra work like I have, or a naturopath's office. So that's the only place you can get this stuff. But the thing with a company like Pure Encapsulations is they hold a pharmaceutical grade certificate. So what it says on the label is there. If they say there's no GMOs, there's no fillers, there's no garbage in their capsule, the capsules that they put their nutrients in, then that's what it is. And they're held by law to that standard. So yes, you're paying a little bit more, but you're getting what you pay for. And again, if we can get back to getting most of our nutrients from our food and getting smarter in our food choices and getting a less toxic grocery cart, then we don't need to supplement as much. So they last longer. My multivitamins alone, I only need to take half of what the recommended dose is. So for both me and my son, our multivitamin lasts about 3 months. So yeah, it's over $50 for a bottle, but it lasts two of us over 3 months. That's where it becomes more affordable, and you're getting the nutrients that you're not always getting because of decreased nutrient density in your food. Okay, enough about pharmaceutical grade supplements, but I'm so tired of people saying, oh, I got these great supplements at Costco or London Drugs and they were on sale. And I'm like, oh, okay, well, we'll see. You know, most of the time it doesn't even get absorbed in the body. So back to food, okay? So fruits and vegetables that are high in vitamin C and, you know, certain cuts of meat, those things are high in vitamin C. So fruits and veggies, certain cuts of meats. So in plants, the concentration of vitamins really is affected by soil quality and planting environment. And unfortunately, that's gone down quite a bit in the last 30, 40 years. But good sources of vitamin C include red pepper, most citrus fruits. So, you know, your oranges, your grapefruits, those types of things. Kiwi, broccoli, and Brussels sprouts. Yes, little Brussels sprouts. Awesome. Power packed full of vitamin C. And smaller quantities of vitamin C are found in tomato and spinach. Now, vitamin E, it's mainly found in your oils and your nuts and seeds. There's small amounts in spinach, broccoli, kiwi, and tomato as well. Now, as far as zinc, their sources are oysters, beef shanks, crab, the dark meat in chicken. So that's kind of the same thing with the beef. So certain cuts of meat, you know, dark meat in chicken. And here's one for you total foodies out there. There's lots of zinc in lobster. So the next time you go to a party, you can say, oh, look, Dr. J says that I can eat lobster because I'm getting zinc, and so it's helping me be less insulin resistant. There you go. So just not too much of it. Okay. All right. So one of the richest sources, so we're moving from the antioxidants now to the anti-inflammatories. One of the richest sources of anti-inflammatory is curcumin. So that's turmeric that we talked about. So that bright yellowy orangey spice found in a lot of East Indian dishes. So curcumin is one I personally supplement with. So I take 500 milligrams a day because those are the amounts that I need to consume because of my dad's side of the family, their tendency towards dying from heart attacks. And so I'd have to be eating, massive amounts of Indian food to get that amount of active curcumin from turmeric. So it's not very practical for me. No matter how much you love Indian food, you'll get sick of it. So there'll be times when you just need to supplement based on your genetics, family history, all these types of things, your lifestyle, or there's times where life is just too busy for you to get it all in. So supplements are there for those times. But again, my general rule is that you need to try and get your nutrients from your food first. Now, I think we've got to be careful because a lot of popular diets and lifestyle strategies have really looked down on fruits. So you need to be careful. There are essential nutrients in fruits. So even the high glycemic fruits and vegetables that have been ostracized by extreme diets in the last few years. So with kind of this new CrossFit wave and sort of the paleo kind of anti-carbohydrate movement, we've got to be really careful because we're missing some essential elements in those fruits, those bright kind of sweet fruits that have some huge amounts of antioxidants in there. So again, it's balance, but you have to be wise and you can't go to these extremes because you're going to be missing some essential nutrients. Okay, so that's insulin. I know we talked a lot about that. I threw a lot of science at you with that. But now let's move on to this other hormone called leptin. Now, I call leptin insulin's little sister. So just stick with me for a second here. Or if you want, little brother. So I can relate. I've just got an older brother. So just so people know that insulin and leptin are related. And they're mainly related in their connection with sugar or carbohydrate metabolism, but they operate very differently. Just like the little sibling who's tired of being known for their older siblings, remember middle school when you showed up first day of class and they're like, oh, my older brother's name's Doug. So, oh, you're Doug's little brother, or, fill in the blank of your older sibling. Anyway, maybe that's just my emotional wound. Sorry about that. So just again, they're related, but behave very differently. So they're a different entity, but they're related. And that's the point I'm trying to make. They're different. Okay. So leptin is the hormone in your body that determines what nutrients will be turned into fat or not. And more importantly, it's critical for mobilizing fat out of storage so that it can be burned as fuel. And as another benefit, it also suppresses appetite. So the more active leptin is, the better. And if you can hack leptin, you are well on your way to approaching a much more ideal body weight and staying there. The ironic thing is that leptin levels decrease as you gain weight. So the more you fill up your fat cells and expand your body size, the more leptin disappears from your body and goes on vacation. See, this is the dirty little secret of the weight loss world. You can starve yourself and lose a few pounds, but unless you deal with leptin, as soon as you stop denying yourself, your body will just fill up the fat cells again, and unfortunately, you may end up larger than when you began. Hey, but don't worry, the weight loss people will be there again next year when you want to fit into those clothes again or go on that beach vacation, and they'll be more than happy to take your money and help you starve yourself all over again so you can lose the same 30 pounds again and again, year after year, season after season. Listen to this stat. In 2012, North Americans spent an estimated $65 billion trying to lose weight. This number's increased from $60.9 billion in 2010, $60.4 billion in 2009, and $58.6 billion in 2008. Okay, enough with the morbidly depressing stats. So how do we get this very, very specialized hormone, leptin, on our side? Now, some of this advice may sound a little old school, but here goes. In reading through the research, and I've been doing this for about a decade on leptin specific, I've found that leptin seems to be one of those hormones that's connected to the rhythms of life. So like consistent sleep times and wake times. So leptin really gets messed up with shift workers and people who don't have a regular schedule. So to hack leptin, try and get as many of your days as consistent as possible. So go to bed and wake up at the same time as much as possible. That actually helps stabilize weight and helps with weight loss. Isn't it crazy? You know, so for me, I try to have the same wake time Monday to Friday, and then give myself a 30-minute sleep-in time on Saturday and Sunday. Now, it doesn't always work. Depends on my kids' activity. Sometimes I'm up earlier on Saturday and Sunday, but the goal is consistent 5 days and then consistent 2 days, go back to the consistent 5 days. Now, another time factor related to leptin is that leptin doesn't like it when you eat before bed. It basically goes on vacation. So this week, I broke this hack, and you know, immediately I knew it when I woke up. I felt groggy and totally off. But you know, rather than beat myself up, it just reinforced that if I want to wake up refreshed and energetic, I need to take my own advice. And yes, there will be times that you mess up, but the next worst thing you can do is go all guilt trip on yourself. Guilt is one of the most destructive and negative emotions on the planet. There is a difference between self-assessment and correction versus guilt. Dump the guilt. It serves no purpose other than to make you feel bad unnecessarily. Get it out of your life and out of your brain. So let's get back to hacking leptin. So if you're trying to hack leptin, it's important not to eat within 2 hours of when you are needing to go to sleep. Better if you can actually stretch it to 3 hours. As melatonin, you may know melatonin as the sleep hormone, as melatonin rises in activity, for some reason, leptin decreases in activity. So the food you eat late at night or right before you go to bed goes directly into storage and will not only disrupt your sleep cycles, but it'll also be harder to get it out of storage because leptin was on vacation. Another hack that will increase your leptin sensitivity is protein in the morning. So we talked about organic eggs, including the yolks, as a source of healthy fats. So an omelet in the morning is a great source of protein. A good shot of protein in the morning is a great hack to increase leptin activation. Again, move away from a grain-based diet as much as you can. Those carbs from grains particularly are not good for your body. And a couple of final things to consider with leptin, getting it on your side. So leptin likes smaller quantity meals, so volume really messes up leptin levels. And as I mentioned in part one, the intermittent fast is a great sensitizer of your body to not only leptin, but also insulin. So if you want to go off the deep end with me and try and determine a day in the week where you can start experimenting with intermittent fasting, I really, really encourage that. So just to plant some seeds, I'm not saying do it, I'm just saying consider it, because it really does make a big difference, especially if you're doing that oil hack in the morning to get your brain going, running on fats. So to begin with fasting, try from supper the night before. So we're talking about the fast day. So go from eat supper at a normal time, say 6 p.m., and don't eat anything before bed. Then start your next morning with some good quality oils and fats first thing in the morning. And even with a cup of coffee, and try to get to lunch. Then stretch it out to supper if you can. Okay, so if you're stopping at lunch, then you're still kind of in the 18-hour range, you know, maybe more like 16 hours. That's a great rest for your GI tract, and it really does, you know, start to sensitize your body to leptin and insulin. But if you can stretch it to supper, you're getting close to the 24-hour period, right? So you're maybe 22, 23 hours, you know, if you don't eat until 5 the next day, you know, and make sure you're drinking lots of water. And you can even look to add some electrolytes. So there's a good electrolyte that Vega makes in a single serve. So it's just in a little pouch that you just dump in a glass of water. And you can pick up that kind of Vega powder at the Bulk Barn in Kelowna. And so you would add that to about every fourth glass of water you have in the day. So you'd like to likely do maybe 2 total glasses with the electrolytes in the day, with an additional 5 or 6 glasses of water throughout the day. So you're super hydrated, and really that also does some great things for your body. So the coffee in the morning here, you know, for more on coffee, check out the site bulletproofcoffee.com. Read it with a grain of salt. So you'll get some really interesting reading from there. Not all good, but interesting for sure. So sites like Bulletproof Coffee are definitely out to sell you stuff, so be careful. He's got some good research, but I'd be hesitant before purchasing products off the site, as I believe he's gone to an extreme in some of his nutritional strategies. But there is some good things that'll get you thinking, and thinking is always good. Okay, enough on insulin and leptin. Let's move on to hack number three, getting clean. Now, I read an article written by a fitness trainer who works in Hollywood. And this trainer was talking about how incredible her client had done in eating clean. You know, in this article that talked about how this star wouldn't put anything but organic in her mouth and that she was super disciplined in the area of eating clean. And hey, I had to agree with everything in the article, but you know, you think about the fact that this movie star doesn't likely worry too much about how much she's spending on her groceries each month, and she likely doesn't even do her own shopping or her own cooking. You know, if you've got a private chef and all these people, you know. So it was a great article, and it certainly gave some positive press to clean eating. And problem is, if you look at the average person who doesn't have a personal chef, personal trainer, someone to do their shopping, and almost unlimited resources, it's easy to see why people think going organic is out of reach. You know, so how do we start getting cleaner without growing broke? Well, the first thing that we learned from our organic growers a couple years ago is the difference between non-sprayed and organic. And it's just like it sounds. Organic farms pay a premium for their licensing. They pay a premium for their licensing to be able to say that their products are organic. And it makes sense. If everybody could just label their foods organic, then it would just be like our natural video that I showed you in our first webinar. We wouldn't know what in the world is in our food or what's been done to it. So we do need regulations on the industry. But regulations that cost money are ultimately passed on to the consumer. So that's you and me. And as much as I want to support our Kelowna's farmers market, and my wife does shop at the Kelowna market a lot, but the growers I interviewed a couple years ago recommended that we made the trip across the bridge to check out Painter's Market. Now, for you guys who are on the west side, that's, you know, exactly where that is, you know, and I know I'm not supposed to play favorites, but what we're talking about is saving money, and I'm going on their 30 years of experience in the industry. They felt you'd have more success in what I'm going to recommend next, finding non-sprayed produce and naturally raised animals rather than certified organic. So non-sprayed crops are not subject to the same cost, so they can be sold for less, and the farmer is still able to make a buck. So it's worth taking some time when you're at the farmer's market to slow down and talk to the vendors. Find out who's selling non-sprayed produce. Find out where farmers are raising grass-fed animals that actually get to walk around outside and breathe fresh air and aren't walking around in hundreds of other animals' droppings before their demise and transport to our dinner table. It may take a few months to find growers and farmers that you can trust, but if it makes going clean more affordable, then it's totally worth it. As an example, when we were back in Ontario, my brother was able to use a neighbor's barn that was sitting empty to raise some animals. And honestly, that was some of the most delicious food we had ever had. So you may be able to get creative like we did, like in a situation like that. And you know, for us, it actually turned out to be cheaper in the end than buying chicken at the grocery store, and no antibiotics and all the other toxic additions, even though it wasn't certified organic. So once you get to know these farmers, it's not only going to help them pay the bills, it can save you money and really help your health. And you'll have a new friend. So that's the difference between organic and non-sprayed. The other thing is that many growers have seconds that they love to sell that they may not be able to sell at the market because their produce is smaller or slightly damaged. These seconds are smaller or slightly damaged. And you can often get produce for cents on the dollar for preserves for in your freezer, right? You know, so you either preserve it or stick it in your freezer. And you will be so glad of that when you can pull that out in the winter. So you may need to buy it in bulk and kind of, you know, do the package it all up and throw it in your freezer. But you know what? You know, this way you're not at the whim of the rising or falling dollar in the middle of the winter when produce prices go up. The other suggestion here is to be practical in your food selections in the winter. You know, have you ever stood in the grocery store and took a huge gulp when you see the price of something that was 50% less last week? Now, some of the prices in Canada, particularly throughout the winter, are ridiculous. So switching to different types of vegetables, like more root vegetables in the winter, can stretch your dollar. Try new things, switch it up. Your family will appreciate that too. Too much of the same thing gets boring. So being smart about what vegetables you choose to bring home in the summer can make the switch in the winter a welcome change. For example, peppers are about a third less in the summer around Kelowna. Berries are crazy expensive in the winter, and don't get me talking about romaine lettuce. I have no idea the price. It's just crazy, So save those types of items for the summer and think outside the box. So all the great phytonutrients that you get from berries, buy them frozen in the winter and add them to your smoothie in the morning. So same product, different presentation. When was the last time you ate beets? Yeah, it's a root vegetable. It is hardy, 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 so it stores well, so it's cheaper in the winter in Canada. And talk about jam-packed full of nutrients. So think practically, and you may do the impossible and keep your grocery bill from causing you a heart attack in the middle of the winter in Canada. It is really tough to get some people to change their grocery list, but if you can think about what items are really outrageous and replace them with other options, it'll save you money and also add to your nutrient diversity. Your body loves it when you switch things up. Now, I found that even the most stubborn people are miraculously motivated to change if they can save money in the process. So make sure your kids know that their Christmas presents are a direct reflection of them eating more root veggies in the winter. And you could at least try. I know I'm stretching it on that one, but hey, try what you can with kids and veggies. And here's another hint to help you out. If you have a Pinterest account, all you need to do is go on Pinterest and type in eating seasonally. And there'll be lists and lists and lists of foods that are in season. So they'll give you the food, a big list, and the month. And generally, produce is more affordable when it's in season in your area. Okay, so I think we're coming in for a landing here. I hope you've got some helpful advice and really enjoyed the webinar format. I know for me, it'll really help me free up some time so I can be available for my growing family and not compromise the quality and quantity of information I'm providing to you. So, as a final summary, here's what we covered in our Nutrition Hacks webinar this week. Be careful who you listen to. Include more healthy fat in your diet, and I gave you a good list to start. Move away from the grains and the sugars. Do whatever you can do to upregulate your parasympathetic nerve system to control cravings and addictions. And I gave you the scientific proven lifestyle strategies, including peace management with meditation, so getting your mind focused, chiropractic adjustments, and diaphragmatic breathing. I talked a little bit more today about the chiropractic, where that fits in for your neurology, but for the most part, we've really moved quickly through that. There's more, way more there, but I've moved through that pretty quickly. Then we talked about the coconut oil, fish oil, vitamin D3 hack to train your body to run on fats and actually have your brain go ketogenic. So for all you keeners out there, you can look that up. A ketogenic diet, there's some cool stuff on that, but we're going to leave that for now. And then we talked about intermittent fasting increasing your life expectancy. And we swung back around to intermittent fasting today too to talk about how that increases your insulin sensitivity and activates leptin. So then in hack number two, we talked about two hormones that are often misunderstood and how you can hack them both, so insulin and leptin. And finally, we came in for a landing about hack number three, and we talked about getting clean. So we talked about some tips and tricks to make sure that by this time next year, your grocery cart is less toxic and your fridge and pantry is filled with less fake food and more affordable and healthy food. And if you want to find out more about this 100 plus living plan or connect with me to see how your spine and nerve system is doing, give us a call at our office here in Kelowna. So 250-870-9136. Or check us out online at lighthousecairo.ca. I really believe that your best health and lifestyle mentor is a great chiropractor. And today's chiropractic is all about a balanced, practical approach to life. If you are having trouble finding a chiropractor in your area that specializes in what we're talking about, then connect with us. I am fortunate to have trained with and even coached chiropractors all across North America. So contact me at my office in Kelowna, so 250-870-9136, and I'll try my best to connect you with a chiropractor in your area that does corrective work and offers the added value, advice, and insight that we all need if we're going to live a long and healthy life. You know, for 120 years, my profession has led the way in common health solutions. And that's my goal, to give you practical and time-tested solutions so you and your family can focus on what matters most. You know, I don't want you to stress about where you're going to be in 30, 40, or 50 years with your health. If you can start doing the things today that build health, you can look forward to a healthy retirement and future. Just like this quote that I was reminded of this week by John Maxwell, small disciplines repeated with consistency every day lead to great achievements gained slowly over time. And just like investing for a healthy financial future, you need to start investing in your physical health a little every day, and you need to have a plan that works. And as much as I loaded you up with a ton of knowledge about nutrition, remember, it's the nerve system that's the engine that drives a solid nutritional strategy. And only a good chiropractor can quarterback that. There's other people who are saying that they can look after your spinal health for you. It is not the same. It is not as specialized and specific as a really good corrective chiropractor. So let's open it up to our questions and answer time, and I'm really looking forward to letting you know who won our three amazing prizes.